Welcome to SNS. My name is Ilinka Benson and I'm Deputy CEO here at SNS. SNS Digitech Forum is our series of seminars aimed for those like yourselves who want to deepen your knowledge and understanding of the digital economy. And this series of seminars is made possible with financial support from Vinnova, the Swedish Innovation Agency, and naturally we are very grateful for that contribution. In a period of technological development with Internet of Things, self-driving cars, and data-driven intelligence, often referred to as artificial intelligence, concerns regarding privacy and principles of data protection have emerged. And I guess that's why you all are here today. Questions that we may pose are, what is required of modern legislation? And how do we make sure that fundamental rights are protected in this new digital environment that we are facing? Today we have invited Professor Mireille Hildebrand to discuss these issues with us. Mireille Hildebrand is Professor of Interfacing Law and Technologies at Vrije Universiteit in Brussels and at Radboud University in Nijmegen in the Netherlands. And we are also very happy to have Niklas Lundblad here with us today. Niklas is Vice President and responsible for public policy and government relations at Google Europe, Middle East and Africa. And he's also adjunct professor at KTH, the Swedish, the Royal Institute of Technology in Stockholm. And today to guide us through this seminar, we have Ulf Wickbom, a very experienced journalist who was also here when the first internet boom sort of burst in Stockholm some decade ago. So please, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much for inviting me. And I'm impressed that you are here, that you made your way through this society packed with crime, violence, anarchy and chaos. I watched Fox News last Friday, so I was quite unsure if I would make my way to this place. Seriously, we are facing two important questions this morning, as Ilinka said. Both are dealing with the same problem, how to protect our integrity and even intimacy in a time when computers are becoming even more faster and smarter and maybe even knowing us better than we do ourselves. The dark side of this is the possible loss of integrity and intimacy. And as a consequence, we might end up losing our individual identity. And if we don't view ourselves as individuals, we have no reason to take any moral standpoint or assume any responsibility for what's going on in the world. Great things are at stake. On the bright side of life, we have big data, machine learning, social media, choice architecture, and the great possible intelligence explosion that could end up bringing us tremendous economic growth, social welfare, and a happiness that we cannot even imagine today. We will expose and discuss this in two time perspectives. In the short term, the General Data Protection Regulation, the GDPR, which is the European Union's new regulation to protect citizens and consumers. It's coming into full force next year, and it will bring about a great change for everyone involved, data providers, banks, insurance companies, consultants and lawyers. And sanctions will be heavy if you break the rules. This regulation is in many respects far-reaching in giving consumers and citizens the right to transparency, information, and even the right to be forgotten by Google, Facebook, Instagram, and Amazon. In the longer term, we will pose the question, will this be enough? Or are computers smart enough to jump national borders and stay one step ahead of all watchdogs? Our two eminent speakers have already been welcomed and introduced, and I give the floor to Mireille Hildebrandt. Welcome. I have been told that you're activated by a button on the back of your green light. Go on.
Yes, after your introduction, I'm also happy to be here in one piece. Now, I've been watching the whole series of Real Humans because somebody invited me to give a talk about it. So when I got this on my back, I said, okay, this is Sweden. I'm going to be a U-bot here. I am a professor of interfacing law and technology at the Free University Brussels. That's at the law and criminology faculty. But I also have a chair at the science faculty in Nijmegen, and that's with the computer scientists. That's a part-time chair. I feel extremely privileged to be there to look from the inside at what computer scientists that I call the architects of our new world, what they're actually doing. Now, of course, these are computer scientists, data scientists. There are also a lot of pseudoscientists outside in the wild, and this is what happens if you apply pseudoscience, or if the real science turns out to be not as fantastic as some people make it to be. So I want to talk about three things. I want to discuss briefly the move from online to on-life. I will explain what that means. Then I want to devote most of my talk to the idea of machine learning, to open it up. And then I will, of course, talk about data protection. So let's start. I was part of a group of philosophers, neuroscientists, computer scientists, sociologists, and lawyers, who were with DG Connect of the European Commission, and who started what we, in the course, there is a telephone somewhere going off. Is that possible? I hope it's not mine. The idea was to look at what all these computational surroundings of human beings and the interconnectedness, these two things, what it would do to human beings. And in the course of this project, we reinvented the name. It was originally conceptual engineering, and you can imagine that this is not a very attractive name to throw out for a larger public. And we took a term coined by Luciano Floridi, philosopher in Oxford, information, the term on-life. So a very brief and very fast history. We started with the internet, with the packet switching and routing system that has fundamentally a network structure. On top of that, we built the World Wide Web. And when I say we, I'm stretching word a bit. This is basically based on the hyperlink, the World Wide Web. This is about hyperlinking. On top of that, we built search engines, blogs, social media, web portals. Now we're moving towards web platforms that offer a whole range of different types of services. And we are now full in the face confronted with the implications of the network effect combined with the filter bubble. I'm not going to explain all these terms. I will assume that at least these terms you're familiar with, especially the term filter bubble here. When you think of reputation damage to individual people because of the network effect and because of filter bubbles, it is caused by the same sort of mechanisms that the filter bubble, brings us the fake news cycles. Of course, we are all carrying our mobile phones, and this is the move towards wearable computers. Everything that is on web platforms, because the phone is just a portal to everything that is in the cloud, all the services. The mobile applications that are on the mobile phone are actually the entry point to the Internet of Things. Computer scientists call that cyber physical infrastructures. So you put cyber on all the things, on all the physical things. Very practically speaking, think of connected cars, whether or not they're autonomous. We're going toward connected cars. Think of energy grids, smart energy grids that are going to depend for load balancing. This is the most critical infrastructure we have, energy. It's going to depend on predicting energy usage behavior of individual persons who want to load their car. I think loading electricity onto an electric car is the same amount as, I think, 200 households. So you can imagine that managing load on the network is quite a job. If you don't try to predict the behavior, it's never going to work. So I would say here we have necessary move to the Internet of Things. And of course, this is all facilitated by cloud computing. So I have a 95-year-old mother. She's being cared for by human beings. It might be that when I reach that age, that is either a luxury or the most stupid thing to do. The jury is out on that, I would say. But if I had such a companion robot, care robot, it would be connected to the cloud. It would never be able to do anything for me if its central processing unit would have to do everything on its own. So it would be exchanging notes with all its peers in the cloud. And that, of course, has many implications, not just privacy, but also my safety. I don't want to be dropped on the floor when I'm 95, not even now, actually. The interesting thing is that the Internet of Things will raise so many information flows that to do all that via the cloud would be very impractical, if not impossible. So you now see a move back towards doing the processing in the direct environment of people, and that is called fog computing. So it means that the cloud comes down a bit. And edge computing, that means trying to do a lot of local processing because it saves you having to connect with the cloud. Well, here you have here you have all sorts of things that can go wrong when you move towards the Internet of Things. This is all about security. Actually, there is a nice anecdote. It was a 4 or 5-star ski hotel in Switzerland, I think, that had the keys to open the doors, so electronic keys, smart cards, because you can collect a lot of data that way. And I saw a newspaper message that said that they had been hacked for the 4th time. They had to pay a ransom. The ransom was 1,500 euros. Which is, of course, much less than trying to reset your entire system. So for the 4th time, they paid because people couldn't get into their rooms and they couldn't get out of their rooms, which is not very nice if you try to run a hotel and hospitality business. And they took the wonderful decision after that 4th time. Guess what? They said, we're going to throw all these smart cards out and give people this very simple physical key. And I think we can learn a lot from that because these technologies are very interesting, but they're not always necessary. Now, I'm talking about security, ransom, hacking. This is more about what my own interest is. To what extent are these systems going to decide our options? This is a cartoon that was in all the EU-funded projects on ambient intelligence and the Internet of Things. It was in all the reports. I don't know who started it. And it raises a lot of interesting questions because, apart from being slightly funny, it raises the question, who decided, who designed this fridge, who programmed it, who made the decision that he cannot take out, what is it, a beer? Did he decide that to keep himself from being weak? Did he decide that out of his own free will, or was the insurance company saying, well, you know, you can get a discount if... And was the insurance company very specific about this, or did they say, well, sometimes we have to nudge you a little bit? Did he realize that this is the consequence? Or was it the government who said, look, we've had enough of all these health problems due to alcohol. We are now sure, due to big data research, you know, big data is going to solve all the problems. So that too, that is bad to have alcohol. So we are just going to really restrict that. And you have no option to choose otherwise. All that is possible. And I think these are the interesting and important questions. So the on life means that the distinction between online and offline is becoming an artificial distinction. You have to work hard to keep them apart. And my point, I've written a book where I use the term on life. My point is that actually these systems are now becoming part of our life world. That means our everyday life world. That it's like the air you breathe, that which you do not notice, that's basically running the show, but you're not even thinking about it anymore. And this is connected with what I call data-driven agency. And in the course of my talk, I'll explain what I mean with that. So this is about creating added value from big data or small data. It's not a law that big data is better than small data. It all depends. And more than that, it depends on which small data, what big data. It is nearly always about predicting behaviors. It can be predicting behaviors of a dike, of a thing. Things also behave themselves, in a sense. But I'm more concerned with prediction of behavior of people. From prediction, you can go to preemption. That means that if the system knows that for instance, that you want to become a vegetarian, you're on the verge, you're still doubting. If you have the right software, you can probably very easily figure that out, statistically speaking, of course. And then the system might sell that information to whoever. That information is worth money, of course. To whoever is capable of changing back your mind by offering you your favorite piece of meat or by sending you banners with the scientific evidence that not eating meat is going to make you very weak and unintellectual or whatever appeals to you. This is about preemption. So with preemption, I mean you're not being told what a system knows about you. The system adapts in such a way that it can predict that this will change your behavior in a certain way. This is happening actually all the time. And, it's very convenient. It makes your environment pleasant. It might even make you happy, but that raises all sorts of interesting philosophical questions on what is happiness. So we'll go into that later. Very important is the difference between the back end of a system and the front end. So we live on the front end. We look at the screens. But there's a back end to the system, and there are other people who can look in the back end, who actually develop the back end. It's not an easy job. And I think it's very important that we get our finger at the back end of the systems, not because we want to be busy with that all the time, but to be able to play around with the system, like we play around with each other and with the institutions that rule our lives. So interfaces, like what you see on your computer screen. And, of course, the narrative is that these screens will one day disappear and everything. The real world will be the interface. This table will know who I am, will be able to sense certain things about my physical condition. So this system itself will become the interface. Now, it's interesting to see that interfaces enable interaction with the back-end system, but also hide the back-end system. And the back-end system is not something we are particularly interested in all the time. So the interfaces also enable to nudge us and even, of course, to force us, because they determine the options that we have. I have a question for you. I often use A-B testing to explain, to make this more intuitive. Who knows what is A-B test design? Okay. Well, I'll then very quickly explain. Imagine you have a website with 10,000 visitors, you change one little thing on that website, just a little a button or the color of a button or the relationship between the amount of text and pictures, etc. Just one thing. You call the original version A, the other version B. You split the 10,000 visitors, 5 go to A, 5 go to B. And of course, you're all the time doing your metrics. You see how these two groups behave. You know how they want, how you want them to behave. If the purchasing behavior of B comes out better for you, you move on to site B. You repeat this all the time. All the time. You don't stop because next week all the other websites will have done the same thing. And to get your competitive advantage, you will have to change again. So I am convinced that all the sites that we like, that I like, that you like, that are convenient, smooth, great, they are continuously being A-B tested. So we are guinea pigs. In the old days in social science, you had to go via the ethical commission to do this sort of research and get permission because you're not telling people. This is, of course, not the case now. The on-life thrives on what I've called a digital unconscious. Digital unconscious is like we have an internal unconscious, and these systems are sort of doing the same thing outside us, so regulating our external environment in a way that is as convenient, as smooth as possible. How does this work? Well, this works via what I've called a big data space. So there are all these behavioral data, clickstream behavior, energy usage behavior, car driving behavior, yawning behavior, eye movement behavior. Our behavior is split up into all kinds of discrete granular behaviors. So there is an accumulation of all this data. But it is distributed geographically. Companies sometimes don't even know where the data is. It's shifting. That's cloud computing. And to make this work, you need also a hypothesis space. You want to make inferences on all this data. You want to learn from it. Otherwise, it's just a burden because you have to protect it against hacking. Servers is hardware. It's expensive to build. You have to cool it all the time. It costs a lot of energy. So the data you're only going to keep if they're going to be an added value. For that, you need a hypothesis space. I will come back to that later. So the storage is distributed, and the access to the data is, of course, distributed. So when I say big data space, that's a very particular type of space. It's not really like a room where you can say, okay, it has four walls, and inside that there is a space. This is a distributed, polymorphous, mobile space. Well, William Gibson is the novelist who invented the term cyberspace in one of his novels, Neuromancer. And I found this a nice quote. This hypothesis space is used to predict behavior. And some people have access to these predictions, and others don't. So the hypothesis space is distributed. I'm not saying that we want to have access to that space. We're not all mathematicians. And even if we were, we might get very bored. But it's important to see that the access to that space and the ability to work on it is distributed. So big data space is actually, with all its inferences and all the automated decisions that are taken in that space and fed back into it, so the results of all these inferences go back into that space. It's like an envelope. In robotics, the idea is that you have a robot and that you create an environment in which that robot can do its work. And that environment roboticists call an envelope. Robots are usually dangerous. They're not people, they're hardware. So they can easily kill somebody. So often industrial robots are kept in a cage for that reason. So we are in an envelope that is, of course, influencing our own agency, our ability to contemplate about things, to make choices, and to think about our choices. This is actually what Weiser, many years ago, many decades ago now, called calm computing. So it all happens under the radar. And what IBM 10, 15 years ago called autonomic computing. IBM said, like, we have an autonomic nervous system. When I'm standing here, because I of course get very impressed with a delightful audience like you, my heart rate goes up. But it's not the case that my autonomic nervous system comes to my cortex and says, Mireille, you are going to give a talk. Shall we put your heart rate up? That would be quite burdensome. I have no access to that system. Unless I do Zen meditation and what have you, I cannot control it in any way. Now, IBM said that is what we need in our environment, a system that, without bothering us, takes care of the environment. Of course, that means that we increasingly depend on the dynamic of interacting systems. We're not talking about one system. And of course, we must always remember that any data, any organization makes, because this is digital data, they are not out there, they are created, can at some point get in the hand of a government. And it's lovely to trust your government, very good thing, but it would be very stupid to build a system where if another type of government appears, it can abuse that system. So actually you should build your infrastructure such that no government can redo the Holocaust or whatever. And if you said that 5 or 10 years ago, people would say, oh, come on, we've learned that's not going to happen. I think everybody now realizes that the jury is out on this. So this is really something we have to think about. Okay, machine learning. Machine learning is, of course, about big data. And big data is now, some people have a religious or pseudo-religious reverence for big data. And I'm worried about that because big data and machine learning is a very complex business. It's very hard work, and you cannot take for granted that anything that has the label machine learning is has methodological integrity, gives you good results. Big data is usually defined in terms of volume, variety, and velocity. You've probably heard these words. Big data can be about big, and some people think that big data means that N is all, that the sample is the same as the population statistics. That is really total and complete nonsense. We never have N is all. You can always translate the same things in real life in different types of data, and you always only have historical data. You never have data on the future. And a lot more can be said about that. Variety, that's about, some people call that unstructured data, the fact that you have data in different formats, audio, video, but also many data that have not been created for the purpose of doing machine learning on them, like emails or what have you, or other records that are in paper that have been digitized. Velocity, you have real-time streaming, or you have data put in databases. Well, then you have open data. I think there's a lot of confusion about what open is, how it is meant. It's usually meant in opposition to proprietary data, where the question is, what is proprietary? Because you cannot own a data in that sense. Usually it's about reusing data for another purpose, so repurposing the data. And often it's about, like we have a directive in Europe which says that government data, public information, should be shared with the industry so that they can build added value on it. Of course, there is an exemption for personal data, and it makes it complex because at some point many data that are on face value, not personal, become personal if you can link them with other data. Of course, when we have the IoT, the Internet of Things, there will be a further explosion of personal data. Working with that will always be high risk, high gain, because you have to protect the data against hacking. And due to the fact that the more data you put together, the easier it is to re-identify data. When you listen to computer scientists, they basically say within 10 years, the term anonymity, anonymous data, will be without meaning. There will be so much data that you can always relate it back to a person if you want to. Probably costs some money. Now about machine learning. This is a definition by Tom Mitchell. He wrote a handbook about it. I think this is a wonderful example of poetry. Poetry is like mathematics. You take out all the extra work words and you keep what is really important. Okay, so he says, we say that a machine learns with respect to a particular task, T, performance metric, P, and type of experience, E. If the system reliably improves its performance, P, a task T following experience, E. There is some feedback loop here. Now, the interesting question is, what is task T? Who is defining that? To work, you have to define it in a sense that that a computer can understand it. Otherwise, it makes no sense. The same goes for the performance metric P. Who determines whether something is increasing what performance or not? Which performances are taken into account? And what experience are we talking about? Well, we're talking about data. The experience of a computer is always an experience of data in machine learning. We have three types of machine learning, broadly speaking, supervised, reinforcement learning, and unsupervised. I'm going to give you some examples, like when MIT and Harvard and Yale started giving online courses, it turned out that this was very popular, so they had to grade a lot of papers, and they don't have the staff for that. So at the same time when they started the MOOCs, they also started developing software to grade papers. It works like that. Let's say that 2,000 students write an essay. The teacher corrects and grades the first 100. Maybe he labels certain things in the essays that he says are very important. Then he gives that to the computer. So he gives them the essays and the grade. And then he basically tells the computer, now you determine the mathematical function between the input and the output, because that's the only thing a computer can do. So you create a hypothesis, which is a mathematical function, that describes the relationship between certain elements, pieces of language, this is natural language processing, and the grade. Okay, done. The next 100 you give to the computer and you say, now you go and grade it based on your mathematical formula. And you do it yourself also. You compare the two and you tell the computer, look, this should have been an 8, this should have been a 5, this should have been a 7. You're doing that wrong. That's called reinforcement. So supervised means you're giving it examples. And reinforcement means that you're saying, no, you're doing that wrong. You should have done it like that. You go on like that until you say, hey, the computer is doing better. Because when I have to grade 2,000 papers, and I see the same wrong answer occurring for the 33rd time, I feel like saying, again, I'm really going to give insufficient, which is, of course, not fair. Also, I'm going to be very tired and after some time. Computers don't get tired. They're very even. So teachers at some point say, okay, after 300-400 essays, the computer is now doing better. I'm now only going to test the bottom part because very bright students use their own language, which the computer may not recognize. So that is sometimes a top paper, while the computer says it's a 1 or a 0. And in this case, you check the 5 and the 6, so the people that are failing. This is what we call training algorithms on a data set. So the first input you give to the computer is called a training set. And then you train algorithms on that data. And then you get spare time to do something else. Some people think teachers are only grading exams and teaching, but that's not true. We have other things. Now, another thing is unsupervised learning, where people say, oh, but this is really different. This means that you have a big bucket, you throw all the data into it, whatever format, and then you throw some algorithms there, and wow, all problems in the world are going to be solved. I'm not joking. I think there are a lot of people, the way they act, you can see that this is what they think. If you would tell them, they would probably say, no, that's not true. But it is often true in the way they behave. Here you have a beautiful example why unsupervised learning is not necessarily the answer to all our problems. So look at the middle picture. You see that this algorithm is being trained on animal faces. So the training set consists of animal faces. Then you present that system with a picture of a flower. You run the algorithms, and guess what? Guess what? It sees animal faces in the flowers. And this is, of course, totally unsurprised. Nobody is surprised that this happens. But this is very obvious. Anybody can understand it. But when we're talking mathematics and very complex issues, we're not going to see that we're going wrong here. We're not going to realize that we've trained it on a particular subset. And it becomes, with deep learning, with neural nets, with unsupervised learning, it becomes much more difficult to test this. And the way to test it is, of course, to take other data sets to train the same algorithm and to look at the difference. Or to use the same data and train other algorithms and to look at the different output. So we need testable machine learning for it to be contestable. I'm going to skip because I get a warning that I have limited time and I want to talk about data protection and how it relates to machine learning. I hope the slides will become available for everybody. You can have a lot of fun, especially if you're a mathematician with Wolpert's no free lunch theorem. He basically proved mathematically that optimization of algorithms all depends on the data set and the algorithms, etc., that there is no way that you have a final algorithm that is going to solve across different types of domains all your problems. Of course, you can take all these algorithms for a ride tremendously. Of course, they can be used in many different ways. Is this readable? Yes. But the important thing is that any machine learning operation has trade-offs. If you want your output fast, you're going to limit your data set. You're going to limit the time for training the algorithms. Then the output will be less accurate. So there are trade-offs in terms of training set, in terms of domain knowledge that you need to build a good, to develop good software. There are trade-offs. The bigger the hypothesis set, that's the amount of different mathematical formulas you allow the algorithms to run. There's going to be a trade-off. If you do too many, you might end up with a very full description of your data set, but it will not apply to the next data set. We call that overfitting. So you give a very accurate description of this data, but it does not apply, it does not generalize, and that is what you want. You want to predict. So there are all these trade-offs. If you pick low-hanging fruit, you say, oh, I have this data, I got it cheap, it's there anyway, so let's do machine learning on this. You might have the wrong data set. We call that garbage in, garbage out. I think it's interesting to use terms like a book just appeared or a year ago, which talked about data hoarding. So we are now in the process of getting too much data, like mad. Like, oh, if I can get data, I can solve problems. That's, of course, nonsense. But there's also something else. There's also in the patterns. The more data you put together, the more spurious patterns you get. So spurious patterns means that there is a correlation between two data points, but it's not causal. It's caused by a third factor. And if you're in a hurry, or you think that it doesn't really matter because it works, you're in danger zone. Sometimes you can take that risk, but it depends whose life you're playing around with. So, very briefly, when you look at what companies, the industry, but also the government now needs, I think that is agile software development. Companies, data scientists, so the people with the domain knowledge, the people who are paying for this, that are investing in a system, and the data scientists should sit down together, iterate, and in that process come to a very precise definition of the purpose of processing. Lean computing, any data you do not process reduces your risks. Not just the risks of the people that you work for, but your risks in terms of liability, data breach, etc. Very important is the methodological integrity. Make your software testable. Open it up. Make sure that different algorithms can be run on your data set, that the data set is secured. That it, if you go into a data set and it's not secured, then it might have changed and not be the same data set tomorrow. That means everything you do on that data set doesn't count, is not valid output. Okay, now let's talk about data protection law. I'm going to move straight on to something very interesting. So machine learning is complex. I hope I've got that message true. And some people say it's basically opaque. Some people call it a black box or whatever you want to call it. But the idea is we are never going to understand what's happening inside. Even the people who develop the technology say that. And I think it's important to open that argument. There are basically three opacity arguments. The first is that you intentionally conceal what's happening. If you're doing national security, that's intelligence services, you're going to conceal what you're doing for a clear reason, security reasons. If you're a company, you might want to protect the algorithms because you want trade secret or IP rights. A totally different argument is that we, data subject people, don't have any connection with all this mathematics. We can read and write. That takes a lot of effort for your brains. It takes years to learn to read and write. Reading and writing changes the morphology of our brains. But we've not invested the same effort in computation. So this is not something we understand easily. Next to that, again, a third argument why this is opaque is that there is a mismatch between mathematical optimization, which is what these systems are doing, and our type of understanding, semantics, meaning. So there's a mismatch, and it's very difficult to have the conversation between these two systems that are generating meaning and something else. The idea of data protection law is that when it comes to law and justice, we cannot settle for computer says no. We cannot say, look, I have this very complex system. It's extremely effective, but I can't explain why I don't accept you for this insurance. It's the machine says it, you are a high risk, so I'm not taking you. The law says, sorry, that's not allowed. Now, basically the law says that making automated decisions based on machine learning, fully automated, that we have a right not to be subject to that. I'm sorry, that is lawyer's talk. If you ask me, does that mean that it's not allowed? Well, the jury is out on that. But at least, very important, we all have a right not to be subject to automated decisions. It's law, so there are three major exceptions. In many cases, it's simply necessary if you want the IoT, the Internet of Things, etc., to generate a whole lot of decisions. Now, if there is a necessity for that, and it's one of the exceptions, then we have three rights. First of all, we have a right to know that machine learning or other automated systems are at work and determined the decision. That's first. Second is you have a right to know what data points inform the decision and how they are weighted. Now, this is my translation of what the law says, that you have a right to meaningful information about the logic of processing, which is like Delphi's Oracle. Everybody is now writing about what that could mean and whether it is a right to explanation or just information about algorithms. But I think the simplest way to understand it is to say, I call it profile transparency. If a decision is made about you, however complex, the output of that decision will be these three data points, the system says, make you a high risk. I'm determining it based on that. So you have a right of access to that. And of course you have a right, or not of course, but you now also have a right. Ah, this is critical infrastructure breaking down. Great. There's a hubot needed to put it all up. Or is that a sign that my time is up? Yeah. I don't know how direct Swedes are. The third right is to have information about the envisaged consequences of this machine learning. So imagine that the taxation office says, well, the taxation law is getting very complicated. We are in a welfare state. We are redistributing income. So we need to have a fair idea who to check. We can't check everybody because that's too expensive. We need all these people. So we're going to predict behavior. I think tax offices all over the world, at least in the welfare states, are now beginning to use machine learning, trying to train algorithms that predict the behavior of taxpayers. And to do that well, they are actually trying to predict everybody's behavior so that they can pick out. There is a famous story in the Netherlands that the department that did this in the Netherlands actually discovered that people who have bought a black car of a specific brand are more likely to fraud than others. And the taxation office was sort of inquiring with experts like, what does that mean? Can we now, is this a good reason to check people with black cars of that brand, or is that going too far? And so we're in the realm of experimentation. What is very important in terms of data protection law is you're only allowed to process data that are necessary for a particular purpose. In this case, the purpose is not to check your application for your filing of your tax, which is what is in the statutes, in the tax law, tax code. This is to predict your behavior. That's not there's no legal statute that says that the taxation office has the duty to predict everybody's tax behaviors. At this moment, that's not in the law. If it were in the law, then you would have to sort of argue that trying to predict everybody's tax behavior is a necessity to achieve the goal of the taxation office. On top of that, you would have to share with people what sort of data points correlate with tax fraud. And you would have to provide the envisaged consequences. So that means you have to tell people, well, if you match this profile, then we're going to keep a close watch on you. Now, is that a bad thing? I don't know. Maybe it's a good thing. If there is a web portal somewhere where I can see these types of behaviors match with that type of fraud behaviors, so if you exhibit this behavior, then you will be checked double. Maybe that's a very good thing, because then I will say, okay, I will not fraud. Actually, criminal law has operated on that premise for a long time. But at this moment, the taxation office will say, let's not tell anybody. Let's not tell anybody, because then they will start gaming the system. This is a recurrent argument. That's why also it's very difficult for a search engine to provide its algorithms to people because they will be gamed, and there are very big economic forces at play to game them. So I think this right, first the right not to be subject to fully automated decisions. There are three exceptions. I have them somewhere, but I think I won't finish all the slides. You can look at it later. And second, the right to information about this. And whether that equals a right to explanation, maybe that is going too far. The point is that you have to be able to get your finger behind what is happening. The point is that companies, governments, have to make their systems testable. And from a perspective of law, making things testable, in this case, will make them contestable. The rule of law is about making things contestable. We don't want the government, we don't want a sovereign to say, look, I have my best intentions with you, just trust me. That was 18th century absolutism. We had enlightened despots. They were great. They did fantastic things. But we decided it's up to us whether your intentions are good. We are going to send you away if we don't like you. We must be able to test what you're doing and to contest it. And that is the rule of law. Well, I had a lot more to say, but I think I will leave it at this now.
Thank you very much, Mireille. Mireille, please remain on the stage. If we go back to your slide 32, could we say that that is the takeaway message? This applies not only to legal systems, but to all activities in societies, in banks and other companies.
Yes, I will give you my last slides because there I sum it up. You see, I could have spoken to you. What I'm trying to say is there is integrity of method. So to do machine learning well, don't look at data protection as a hindrance. It's your biggest ally. If other companies are allowed to do all sorts of things and you will be pushed out of the market if you don't go along, you have a problem. The GDPR puts a bottom, a threshold there. So if you want to do effective machine learning that is creating real added value, the GDPR is going to be your asset. That's my takeaway message.
Another takeaway message: we should not only learn to read and write, but also to program, or at least understand programming, because that's the language, the foreign language of the future.
Yes.
Please come and stand beside me, and we invite Niklas Lundblad to the stage to comment, and was that last slide a blueprint? You can stand over there.
Oh,
you
can take the floor. Thank you.
The last slide, was that a blueprint for Google's future as well?
Yes, we were looking at the GDPR, of course, in order to understand how it will be implemented across all of the different fields that it covers. One of them certainly is how to think about machine learning, transparency, and the ability for people to understand the inferences that are made about them. This is something that the industry has actually been working on for quite some time. And yes, it is. Yes, it's green at least.
In the meantime, I remind you all of the hashtag SNSKunskap in one word.
Yes. And so I would say that that's something the industry has been working on for quite some time, the ability to make transparent what kinds of inferences in a meaningful way, because I think that's one of the points that Professor Hillebrand makes. And meaningful is an interesting concept because it boils down to a couple of different factors. One is the information needs to be presented, it needs to be rich, but then you also need to sort of almost lure people into being interested in it as well. So you need to make it interesting and something that they come across. And we've been working a lot with DPAs across Europe to figure out how we can make our privacy policies and the different tools that we provide available to consumers. And it's not an easy thing. At some point, we elaborated with human-readable privacy policies, which made our lawyers very disappointed because they felt they were humans too. but the idea is that you always have to think about how you can make people not only have the ability to make informed decisions, but also the interest in making those informed decisions. Mm-hmm. So I think that's one part of it.
And that's some kind of manipulation to...
It is, in a sense, just like, you know, it's a manipulation when we have public campaigns for health or something like that, where you're trying to have people care about things that you believe are truly important for them, but also for the long-term trust they have in the system. I mean, these things are not, it's not just about telling users, you need to go have a look at this. It is ensuring that in the long term, the trust in the system actually is preserved. Because what will happen over time now, of course, is that these systems will just become more and more complex. And as they become more complex, trust in them will be even harder to maintain. Because complexity breeds unpredictability, and the ability for us, as biologically bounded human beings, to understand these systems is limited. So we have to, at this stage of our computer society's history, make sure that we have the mechanisms, the institutions for trust, so we can continue building on those as these systems rapidly become more complex.
Is there a conflict between the regulators and the consumers on one side and Google companies on the other side? Because
I would say there's certainly a tension. I mean, it would be silly to say that we are all one happy family, right? I think that there's a tension here, and the tension is that I think that we sometimes want to be able to do more things than the society thinks is able. We should be able to do, and that's fine, right? That's a dialogue that we should be having.
And what is that?
Well, look at purpose limitation. I think it's a really interesting question. So the way we frame these things matter. So my favorite narrative around artificial intelligence goes back to 1969. Herbert Simon, the well-known computer scientist and Nobel laureate, wrote an excellent paper back then, a talk really, that he was giving at the Brookings Institute, called Designing Organizations for Information-Rich Environments. And in this paper, he wrote a sentence that's been quoted to smithereens, which says that with a wealth of information comes a poverty of attention and the need to allocate attention efficiently. And this has been repeated over and over again, but people have not read the whole paper. They usually never do. They found the quote and they stop. So if you read the whole paper, his conclusion is we will not be able to deal with information overload unless we invest massively in artificial intelligence. Mm-hmm. And at the end, he says, and the reason for all of this, the sole reason for investing artificial intelligence is to improve and enhance human learning. Now, how do you square the notion of purpose limitation with learning? Learning is exploration, it's, you know, finding new things, it's innovation. But what you're saying when you're talking about purpose limitation is that, well, you have to define beforehand what you want to learn. Mm-hmm. Which is not easy, and there's a tension there. I think there's certainly a reasonable limitation, and there's certainly reasonable questions about what kinds of learnings we want as a society. But I think that is a really interesting perspective for us to think a little bit about.
Can I immediately step into that?
Yes, please.
Because I think there is there's one of the, I would say, let's say it friendly, one of the big misunderstandings now. I hear this everywhere, especially at a global level, because purpose limitation, which is basically a constitutional law principle, which used to be valid for governments and not for companies. And it somehow got into the Data Protection Directive and into the Data Protection Regulation. Now, I often hear this when you have big data or when you want to learn, you cannot in advance determine what you want to learn.
Well, I think you can, but to a certain extent.
Yes, and it's this certain extent. It's also about a direction. Like, let's take the example again of the department in the Dutch tax office. I'm sure it's all happening here. They would say, well, we need all the data of all the taxpayers, and we're going to play around with it. We'll invite consultants who have quants, people that are trained in theoretical physics and mathematics, and we'll put them there, and then we will see what we can get out of the data. So, a purpose before? No. That's, of course, nonsense. There is one purpose that stands out in the beginning. Predicting the behavior of taxpayers. That is, let's say, the top-level purpose. That's a very broad purpose. That's not even yet trying to predict fraud. You're trying to predict the behavior of taxpayers based on the data that the tax office has. Now, let's start by admitting that. Let's start by saying you are obliged to open up and to say that that's what you're doing. Tell it to people and then listen to them, whether they're going to like it, that the tax office, based on what many people feel is very sensitive data, it's not sensitive data in the sense of the law, but what people feel is very sensitive data, because it's not just your data that you've given to the tax office, but it gets all sorts of data from private enterprise. Now, that's the first thing. Then you can have a real democratic discussion about whether that's what we want. Now, when you are doing agile computing and you're sitting down, preferably not with these consultants that have their own purposes, I would say if you bring in a consultant, that consultant is going to be a data controller. I'm sure that in the contract between the consultant and the tax office, they will say that they're going to train their algorithms on our data and they're going to keep intellectual property rights on those algorithms. I think that's quite problematic.
Will the Dutch tax authority have to change when the regulation comes into force? Is this what the regulation tries to solve?
I think that already under the current directive, purpose limitation gives the data protection authority, they are now doing an investigation into this, the right to intervene. Because this purpose is not in the Dutch taxation law.
I think that's right. And I think that there it sort of traces back to the 1980 OECD principles and then further back to the genealogy of data protection law. Where data protection law usually, I mean, its roots are interesting when we talk about this because there are path dependencies in everything. And I think the path dependencies in the roots of data protection legislation is that it came from a general fear of citizens that the government would be able to collect too much data about them and hence control them. And I think it's beautifully formulated the way you say you should build an architecture so that it can be overtaken by an authoritarian regime and not be used to perpetrate crimes against humanity. That's a really difficult task, but it's an extraordinarily good principle. And I wholeheartedly agree with that. I do believe, however, that when we discuss this, we need to segment it and talk about use cases. So we don't get stuck in the government use case, but we talk about the different use cases. And there's an interesting question where purpose limitation sort of runs up against the where the necessary narrowness of purpose limitation runs up against the idea that there are data sets from which we can learn quite general things. So the classical example, the big example is, of course, health data. But now, if you look at health data, for example, you collect all of the health data of an entire nation, and you say, I would like to learn from this, and I would like to learn as much as I can. That would not be allowed under the purpose limitation principles. And maybe that's okay, but that's a discussion that we should have as a society. Because if you assume that we can learn things that can improve health and actually make sure that people survive longer, then we have one value on the one hand, which is the survival of people, the health of people, the general well-being of people, and the purpose limitation value on the other hand. But this is a data set and a use case that's very different than the government use case, because the government use case is one in which the exercise of power and control is inherent.
Keep it short, Mireille. I want to bring Google into the picture.
Yes. I couldn't disagree more here, because one, the purposes are health. Our health. So it's not that purpose is against generating preventive medicine, because that's what we're talking about. This is your high-level purpose, to do experimentation. I think a lot of the talk about purpose limitation not applying is when you're trying to experiment. So you have data sets, you have algorithms, you have good people, you have domain knowledge, you sit down together and you do agile computing on all this. Then you could say in those cases the high-level purpose is experimentation. But it's never experimentation full stop. It's experimentation in this case for health. So they're not opposite. You have to first say we're doing this experimentation to create a better health care or better medicine. Then you have to look very carefully at who is doing this. Is this a pharmaceutical industry? Is this a hospital? Is this academics? And then you have to take that into account, that the purpose is not just health. The purpose is I want to make money on algorithms so that I can say I now have some solutions which I would never have found. I totally agree with you. If I didn't have access to all this data. But I paid for the investment. So now I want to have return on my investment. So I'm going to close that knowledge off. And here it becomes interesting because
I told you to keep it short.
And I have to reply to that. Because I think it's interesting, right? I think that there are two different questions. One is the sort of the general outcome of what you're doing with the data. The other is the actual legal possibility of having a broad purpose. And that's my point is very narrow. My point is that the kind of purpose I just described is not allowed under the 9546 EC or the GDPR, which means that you would not be able to do general mining or general learning from a data set that large. And that's been, if you look at the application of DPAs, of the purpose limitation principle, that has been a recurring theme. And so I think that's the... But that's sort of in the weeds, but there you
but
go.
I really need to make a point here. Yes. I would say, from the DPD and the GDPR, if you have that much of a high-level purpose, which is much more specific than you're saying, it's not just doing general research, blah, blah. It's experimentation for this purpose, good health, by this entity, that means there are also other purposes. High level means you have to pseudonymize the data. So then you have to get, for instance, a legal ground. So you need people to consent. Yeah. Then you have this as a purpose. Actually, it falls under the exemption of scientific research. So what are we talking about? But okay, if there's a company involved, you will have to be a bit more specific. Then saying this amount of data we have to pseudonymize. And if you do that in an intelligent way, pseudonymization is again very hard work, of course, then you could say that is your way of complying. So it's data protection by design. So I totally disagree that this is not allowed. One, it falls under the exception for scientific research. And two, as soon as it is clear that there are ulterior motives, then they have to be specified. And yes, you can still say, I'm just doing experimentation. I don't even know yet whether I'm talking about cancer, about blood disease, because the beauty is that you can do cross-researches. Maybe our whole idea of this is the Department of Heart Diseases, this is the Department of Cancer Research, is going to disrupt it. I'm all in favor of that.
And I would wish that you became a DPA, and I'll send you a case in particular that shows that this is not the way they think about it. It's an interesting...
I could listen to you for hours, but I think I must ask Niklas, how is Google adapting to complying to the new regulation? There must be some kind of change, because otherwise you wouldn't have a regulation.
Oh, certainly. Yeah, no, we have a dedicated engineering team in Mountain View that are currently working to understand and implement the GDPR. And there are things like, you know, how can we make sure that access is much more thorough? How can we make sure that control over the data is much more thorough? How can we design solutions for data portability that are within the compliance space of what the directive allows for? We've had some of these services, but that doesn't mean that they will not need to be improved and need to be developed more under the GDPR. So there's a dedicated engineering team working on this, and there will be a number of launches during 2017 where we try to show what we believe the engineering adaptations look like.
Is there any change in quality when it comes to protecting consumers and citizens, a radical change in the view of their rights?
That depends on what you mean. I think there's always been the sense that the consumers and citizens have rather extensive rights when it comes to the protection of their data. I mean, we're not just talking about data protection, then we're talking about information security. Information security is partly a hygiene issue for all of the internet companies, partly a really important trust issue for the entire industry, and also something that I think every single internet company prides itself on being very good at. Then you have data protection issues. And there is, in some cases, I think, more protection. But there is, I mean, the great big win with the GDPR is that you're finally getting a coherent rule book for 28, soon to be 27 member states in the European Union. And that allows you to also develop a much larger body of practice. It allows you to develop an implementation understanding that is common for Europe. And I think it's going to have the same effect that traffic regulation has had for California. It will sort of be a race to the top for other countries as well.
Is codifying the different rules the great asset? Or is this a great step ahead for protection of consumers?
Yes. I think
in what respect is it a great step ahead?
I think the reasons you're giving, I think the content of the regulation and the directive is not that different. Data portability is an exception that's new. But as I read, data portability is quite you can read that quite restricted. So the California effect that has been coined by a US scholar, the Brussels effect of data protection, I really think that works. So since Europe has a big consumer market, the American companies will find it very important to reach that market. So they're going to upgrade their protection to the level of Europe. And they're not interested in having within their company globally all these different levels of protection. So that will upgrade the protection also outside Europe, also because Europe requires other countries to have adequate protection. So then it's the easiest thing for the industry, not just Google, but all its competitors to comply with that. And the 4% fine over global turnover, that means that the regulation speaks to the board, not to the privacy officer. So the board will then say to the privacy officer, you get it right. I'm not going to suffer. You get it right. And then you get a totally different atmosphere.
I think that's right. And I mean, it focuses the mind to have the 4% fine. I think that's right. And I think it's a good thing, really.
But we know that data travels freely over national borders, and servers could be placed in unknown nations on tiny islands in the South Pacific. Will the sort of the bad guys find loopholes so the regulation will be in part worthless?
There's a Plato noted that good people don't need good laws and bad people don't care about good laws. And I think that's been true since Plato. And so, of course, there will be abuses. But I think it's really important to focus on those abuses as well. One question you're asking is, how do we distribute enforcement? And I think that's a really interesting question. I think the DPAs have been focused on making sure that the large, rather benign, good actors are currently complying, which is a very legitimate thing for them to do. But I would like to see scaled up enforcement on those really bad cases where you see people abusing the data privacy rights even under the 9546 EC. And stronger focus on the enforcement at the edges would probably be a good thing too. And it doesn't mean that they have to stop looking at compliance. They can do both. But I think that would be really helpful.
Let's open up for questions from the floor. You wait until you get a microphone, and please stand up. And you can even tell us who you are before you put your question. We have one question over here. We have two microphones, one there and one there.
Hi, my name is Jakob Dexe, and I'm from SIX Swedish ICT. So one thing that you started talking about, pseudonymization. And one thing that I see in the GDPR is that a lot of the legal concepts have a technical baseline, which is hard to define. We don't know what the limits of pseudonymization technologies are. And a lot of the other concepts are also limited by the technological abilities we have. So how do you partly view that, and partly what is the European Court of Justice actually going to do when they actually don't have a concrete limit to what is possible?
Yeah, I think that's a very good question. I believe that the GDPR is not limited by the technological situation, but that it actually finally, as a law, takes into account that you have to see where the technology stands. So there's a lot of state-of-the-art talk in the GDPR. It basically means that technologies that let's use that word, empower data subjects. if they are state-of-the-art, a data controller cannot say, well, I don't like that technology. It will have to use state-of-the-art technologies. And which that are, that's something for the companies to figure out. So there will be a market for this type of technologies, very specific to pseudonymization. Pseudonymization in the regulation is defined as any data that is kept separate from additional data that could re-identify. So basically, you are required to keep data separate in your systems. And at any time that the chance that those two get together is too big, it doesn't count anymore as pseudonymization. And you also have to take into account that the last case from Luxembourg, the Breyer case, means that if I have only data and not the additional data, they are simply with another company. They're not under my control. But it would be pretty easy, for instance, via law enforcement, to put the two together, then my data counts as personal data. Pseudonymous data is personal data. So I think the way it is formulated is, I didn't formulate it, but I think it's brilliant. And it offers the industry a playing field to develop really good, sound technology. Instead of, I trust Facebook and Google with my data because they have a high reputation to guard. But I also think they have very excellent people and they have a very large company. But there are a lot of startups that are doing crazy things with data. And that are sort of, people say, well, you know, they've just started. But you've all seen the Admiral case. It was an insurance company who said, we're going to charge you to decide on the price of your car insurance premium based on your Facebook behavior. And it was all over the news and everybody said, oh. And then came Facebook. And Facebook said, are you crazy? I'm going to cut your API out. This is not at all allowed. Now, of course, everybody on my side, the privacy people say, ha, ha, ha. If it hadn't come out, Facebook wouldn't have minded. I'm not so sure. I think Facebook sits on our personal data. It's its golden egg. They don't want to share that with all sorts of creepy experiments with our data. So,
I think that's a good question deserves another answer as well.
Well, so the state of the art language is actually in the 9546 EC2 for information security. You're obliged to have state of the art security for your system. So that's not really a change, I suppose. It's sort of an extension of a principle that has not been widely tested in law. So I think it'll be interesting to see what the case law looks like, because what you'll end up is having courts determine what the state of the art of technology is, which I think will be interesting. And there is another alternative regulatory model, of course. I mean, the way that this has been discussed in American academic writing is that there would be a possibility to use a model where you actually regulate re-identification. Because you say it's hopeless. Every anonymized or pseudonymized piece of data can at some points be identified again. So to regulate, you know, this category of data is actually less efficient, economically efficient, than regulating re-identification. So you're not allowed to re-identify. And then make that be the regulatory significant moment in the processing of data. So I think these both models have sort of advantages and disadvantages. I think my only regret would be that the re-identification model was not thoroughly examined in the work of the GDPR. I think it would have been great to see them weighed out in that work a little bit more. But, you know, there was probably not enough time, and that was pretty nascent writing.
Yes, please. If you stand up, wait for the microphone. Oh, okay.
Hello, my name is David Flödlinger. I'm an privacy attorney at Lindahl Law Firm. So you discussed the rules about profiling and the right not being subject to automatic decisions. But you also, when you discussed machine learning, you said something interesting about how to use machine learning to actually frame the choices we can make. And I was wondering if you could elaborate a bit more on that from a sort of legal perspective. I have some thoughts of my own, but I would like to hear your view on that and under the GDPR, because there's many things that can be done there also, I mean, on the web, of course, but also in the grocery stores or in other places.
Maybe it's good if you give your view, because first?
I have thoughts. I have not a conclusion yet.
You are a lawyer. I can hear that.
You know lawyers, lawyer, don't you?
Yeah, yeah. It depends.
I think what I did in the slide, but I never got down to it, because I try to look around at the audience and see whether I have to slow down or move up. It's always difficult to foresee. But there is this term choice architecture. It's a term from cognitive psychology and behavioral economics, a term that is used by both companies and governments now to nudge us in the right direction. So the choice architecture is the way your environment is giving you choices or not. And some people say that's paternalism. Your environment is always giving you certain choices and not others. So that's the default. You can't get away from that. The point is, are you thinking well about it as a government or as a company? Now, preemptive computing has a certain choice architecture. That means that to a large extent, I am not aware of what choices are being made for me. Now, I'm hijacking the term choice architecture and using it for the data protection regulation. I'm saying the GDPR is creating a specific choice architecture for data controllers, telling them this is not allowed. If you do it, you get fined or you pay private law liability fines, compensation. This is allowed. This is how you should do this. So there is a choice architecture now for data controllers, which is brought up to level because it's enforceable. And what you're interested in is what is the choice architecture that data protection regulation gives for data subjects. And there I think the right to erasure, the right to be forgotten sounds very melodramatic. Let's say there is a right to erase specific things, very specific things. You can't go to Google and say, please erase me. There is no law that allows you to do that.
Right? In fact, there are laws against us erasing you. So
yeah, exactly.
Did you get a useful answer to take back to your law firm? Next question, please.
Hi there. Stanley Greenstein, Department of Law, Stockholm University. Mirelle, you mentioned the...
Could you speak up a little more?
You mentioned the GDPR and that it gives the individual certain rights. for example, the right to the logic behind predictive analytics and predictive models. Yet at the same time, does say that trade secrets and intellectual property rights go first in the preamble. How does one reconcile that contradiction or watering down of these rights?
Well, I find that very simple. Not everybody agrees, of course. The recital doesn't put IP and trade secret first, but it says... It seems to give something like the right to profile transparency, and then suddenly comes another hand that seems to take it away and say, yeah, but you can't violate trade secret and property rights. But then the last part of the recital says, but those property rights and trade secrets may not overrule the substance of data protection. So it again takes it. Now, for lawyers, of course, that's nothing new. We're not computers, we're not if this then that, we're not imperative program contraptions. We're persons. Law is about language, about ambiguity, about proportionality. Now, the difference between the Data Protection Directive and the regulation is that it says meaningful information. And for me, that solves the problem. So what you cannot do as a company or a government is take a handful of algorithms out of your deep learning pocket, and throw them in the face of people and say, well, here you have the logic of processing. That's what I have to give you. No, it has to be meaningful. So those algorithms, the DPA, Data Protection Authority, can go and check because it has access to the premises, to the systems. There is an auditing requirement. They have to show what they're doing. But us citizens, we are not interested in algorithms. So you have to give meaningful information, and that means basically the clash with trade secret and IP rights is gone. You just have to tell a person, look, people with a black car of that brand are fraudulent in 67% of the cases. And my conclusion is that that means that your premium goes up with 67%. Anybody who has statistical knowledge will probably shiver because this is very silly application of statistics. But in practice, that's how it works. Once you have told that to somebody, somebody can go to court and say, look, you can't seriously refuse or raise a price because of those data points. Actually, they don't apply to me. I can prove that.
And I will start selling white cars in Holland. It's a great business idea.
Sorry?
I will start selling white cars in Holland. The fraudulent guys will realize that they have to mix as another color. We must sort one thing out, Niklas. You said Google cannot erase and must not erase anyone. But the regulation talks about the right to be forgotten.
I was being facetious. I was just saying that erasing people back and forth is not something that you can do, because a part of data protection is also, of course, the integrity of the information.
But how does this comply with the regulation's idea of the right to be forgotten?
Well, the right to be forgotten is, of course, something that we're implementing. And we've implemented it ever since the Costea decision. And it's, you know, we have a number of different cases all openly reviewed on our transparency report. So that is something that I think will be... it will be one of the things where we have an already existing practice and an already existing compliance infrastructure that we will think about how to apply to the new GDPR.
We have time for one more question, please.
Thank you. I'm Cecilia Magnusson-Sjöberg, Stockholm University, Professor of Law and IT. I have one question concerning the regulatory framework as such. Now we're moving from a directive to a regulation, and formally speaking, that means quite a difference in that the regulation is to be applied in each member state. But then if you look closer, if you actually see what's going on in the member states, you see that there are evolving national, supplementary, general legislation. And in addition to that, there are, for instance, in Sweden, approximately 20, a bit more than 20 public inquiries looking into how to adapt to the GDPR. So that's kind of, it would be interesting to hear if you think the regulation as such is kind of a hybrid. And furthermore, the complexity. I mean, we are talking about a framework. If we just look at the information duties to be fulfilled in different ways. Yep. Well, the complexity. So the legal framework as such, and also the complexity. I mean, there's one thing, you have your expertise groups. Mm. Yeah, I'm sitting.
If you want an answer, I must break
absolutely
you off now.
Thank you very much.
Please keep them short. Time is running out very quickly.
Well, it's ours to lose. I think you're right. I mean, we can really lose the harmonization effect of the GDPR through too much national adaptation. It's not implementation, but adaptation. And the adaptation problem is a real one, because the GDPR's great benefit was that it was supposed to apply equally everywhere. And, I mean, for us, it's okay, sort of. We have an enormous range of expertise in law, in engineering. We can adapt to a 200-page framework. But it's harder for a European startup to do. So it's a little bit a question of how the European Commission wants to reconcile its economic message on startups, growth and jobs, and how they want to reconcile their message on data protection. I hope that they will be strong enforcers of the regulation format.
I totally agree with the complexity, and I think one of the messages that companies are going to learn, and it will take time, government also, is the more data you collect and process, the more trouble you're collecting. If that's a message, then I think it's a good message, because if you know how to avoid data obesitas and pattern obesitas, you will do much better and effective machine learning. And there's a lot more to be said, but that's not allowed now.
Ilinka, come up on the stage and listen to my final question, the answer to that. When I prepared myself for this task, I read much about computers becoming smarter than we are, understanding us better than we do. Will they be able to make us happier than we can ever imagine that we are, can be? Mireille.
Well, I think Google has the answer to that.
Niklas, will Google make us happier than we could even imagine?
I'm afraid we're going to have to leave that to everyone, each and everyone themselves, to make themselves happy. And, you know, Nietzsche used to say, you know, nobody cares about happiness, only the English do.
Well, on that...
With this final message from Google.
Yeah. Yes.
Thank you very much, and thanks for a very informative morning on a fascinating topic. Thank you to Ulf, Mireille and Niklas, and of course all of you. We'll continue this series further on, so keep an eye out for our upcoming seminars. And I would also like to mention... some seminars. We have other topics. One is on a governmental lending program that was implemented during the financial crisis and will be commented by Carolina Ekholm from the finance department on March 7th. And the other is on the waiting time for asylum seekers, which will be commented on by Mikael Ribben-Wik from the Agency of Migration here in Stockholm. So very welcome back. And if you want to talk more to Mireille, please do that outside, and also, of course, to each other. Thank you for today.
Thank you.